Excellencies, distinguished members of the Pontifical Academy for Social Sciences, ladies and gentlemen. I'm grateful for the invitation to take part in this event, organized by the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences, jointly with the Association Europe, the Patient, and the Center for the Thought of John Paul II. I would especially like to greet the President, His Excellency, Archbishop Marcello Sanchez Orondo, together with panelists and organizers of today's symposium. The title of the conference, Healing Patient Europe, opens up many questions, both because of the magnitude and grandeur of the patient in need of healing, and because of the very question underlying the title. Is Europe truly sick? The various panels scheduled are intended to address the different illnesses of patient Europe in an attempt to suggest ways it might be healed. Certainly, the pandemic has highlighted the numerous crises that the continent has been going through for several years now. Pope Francis, during the meeting of the heads of state or government of the European Union on the 60th anniversary of the Treaties of Rome, had listed some of them, including the economic crisis that has marked the past decade. There is the crisis of the family and of established social models. There is a widespread crisis of institutions and the migrant crisis. So many crises that engender fear and profound confusion in our contemporaries who look for a new way of envisaging the future. The end of the quotation. However, the Pope continues, the term crisis is not necessarily negative. It does not simply indicate a painful moment to be endured. The word crisis has its origin in the Greek verb krino, which means to discern, to weigh, to assess. Ours is a time of discernment, one that invites us to determine what is essential and to build on it. It is a time of challenge and opportunity. End of quotation. In light of the Pope's words, it should be first noted that in the face of the various illnesses that will be discussed in more detail in the panels of these days, we cannot lose hope. These are pathologies that can be cured, and we need to cultivate confidence and hope that they can actually be overcome and healed. The pandemic has undoubtedly highlighted in a more dramatic way the difficulties that had already gripped Europe over the last few years. At the same time, it has made it clear to everyone that no crisis can be solved in a solitary manner, starting from individualistic positions. As Pope Francis pointed out at the beginning of the pandemic, no one reaches salvation by themselves. For this perspective, the pandemic seems to have reawakened consciences, especially in the political world, making people aware that both health and economic issues that have resulted from the current emergency need to be addressed together. In this sense, some encouraging steps have been taken in recent months. Overall, the pandemic has challenged us with two fundamental urgencies. The first is precisely the need to address the current problems. We cannot stand by and think that these problems will solve themselves. In the first place, those with political responsibility have the burden of making decisions, sometimes unpopular, that are necessary to emerge from the crisis and to move forward. Secondly, the pandemic has shown us that it is necessary to change certain paradigms to which we have become accustomed and which are often passively accepted, especially in the economic sphere. We need what Pope Francis has called a kind of new Copernican revolution that can put the economy at the service of men and women, not vice versa. An economy at the service of integral human development rather than of particular interests that does not lose sight of the social significance of economic activity and the universal destination of goods and resources. Bringing about a new Copernican revolution means replacing the individualistic logic that tends to objectify and discard with a spirit of inclusive solidarity. Unfortunately, solidarity is clearly challenging. We find ourselves reluctant to work together, especially when faced with migrants and refugees, and are more easily given a feeling that a profound lack of confidence in Europe and its potential, which also makes us unable to deal with the fears arising from the various crises we face. The Copernican revolution of which the Pope speaks begins with the desire to recover trust that is, through the rediscovery of places of trust that find their center in the inseparable combination of person and community. This is the heart of Europe's path to recovery, since recovery cannot start from abstract reasoning, but rather from the concreteness of people who have faces. They force us to assume a responsibility that is real, personal, and effective. While statistics, however useful and important, are about arguments, they are soulless. They offer an alibi for not getting involved because they never touch us in the flesh. The first path to healing, therefore, calls for the person to be put back at the center, bearing in mind that the person must always be understood in its unrepeatable and inviolable uniqueness and as the center of consciousness and freedom with transcendent dignity. The human person must also be understood as relational, since they are at the center of that network of communal and social relationships at the heart of which is the family. Considering healing means primarily talking about health. The pandemic has emphasized some of the strengths, but above all, the weaknesses of our health systems, which are often divided and fragmented. COVID has highlighted the fact that in the face of a global threat, a unanimous response from both the medical, scientific, and the political economic communities is essential. The sharing of scientific research and universal access to treatment are also increasingly seen as indispensable for tackling forthcoming emergencies, all of which will be global in nature, given that we live in a completely interconnected world. The pandemic, therefore, is a unique opportunity to refocus politics on people and their integral development, rather than on procedures that burden citizens' lives. However, the pandemic is also causing a number of social rifts, which should not be underestimated. Political commitment requires working for the common good, and this entails fostering harmony, friendship, and social cohesion, avoiding divisive attitudes, and fostering societies that develop a sense of common belonging proper to a community. The second path to healing is closely linked to the first and requires investing in people's gifts and talents. These are Europe's great resources. From this perspective, we must look first to young people and at education and work, two needs that are closely linked to our youth and not only to them. Over the past few years, over the past year and a half, young people throughout the world have suffered from the impossibility of attending school or university in person because of the pandemic. Distance learning, made possible by new technologies, has proved to be an important opportunity, but it has also shown considerable limitations, especially with regard to the personal and social development. Investing in education is not just a matter of putting resources into learning programs and tools, but primarily in creating educational communities in which interpersonal relationships can be developed, starting with the fundamental relationship between the student and the teacher. It is the latter who is called upon to lead the student towards full knowledge of himself and of reality. In fact, the day before yesterday, the Global Compact on Education was held here in the Vatican, the aim of which was to place the person at the center of every educational process, to invest more into quality education for all and efforts to train people who are willing to put themselves at the service of the community. The pandemic has also tested us with a major economic crisis, the effects of which seem to be easing now, but of which the consequences need to be assessed in the long term. In the last year and a half, the very perception of work has changed considerably, often becoming remote and individualistic. Automation and the development of artificial intelligence tend to reduce employment opportunities in some sectors. The rigidities of the labor market and the problems of social security systems also make the process of entry and exit from the marketplace. In this context, we have a common and serious responsibility to seek solutions that create employment opportunities, facilitating the integration of new generations, as well as adequate retirement conditions for other older people and workers in particularly demanding sectors. Finally, the general rethinking of the economy triggered by environmental challenges and the ambitious European Green Deal project, offers us an opportunity for growth. We are facing a major challenge that also involves man's very relationship with nature and his surroundings. It is therefore an opportunity not to be missed, both in order to develop the Copernican revolution I mentioned before, and to recover a balanced relationship with the environment that industrial processes challenged in the 18th century, and that ensuing urbanization has broken. The balance requires human resources, and in a continent that tends to age rapidly, the contribution of migrants constitutes a significant additional resource. We know how the migration issue divides both individual countries internally and states internationally. We need to overcome the numerical logic that generates fear and exclusion. The Holy Fathers continually reminded us that migrants are first and foremost people. They must be welcomed, and above all, they must be integrated into the human and social fabric before being integrated into the economic fabric. Integration is undoubtedly the most complex and frightening aspect because it is the most demanding. It is much easier to marginalize than to integrate migrants, because to integrate another culture into your own is only possible if you are certain of the foundations that support your own. This brings me to the third path of healing, which I would like to mention only briefly. It is a cultural healing, which might be described as a cure for our memory. For the Pope, it is necessary, in fact, to have a memory transfusion. We need to remember to take a step back from the present to listen to the voice of our forebears. Unfortunately, it is evident that Europe is frightened by its own history, undoubtedly linked to Christianity, and not only to that, and therefore often strives to deny it, thus attempting to build a future on shaky and fragmented foundations. We often talk about European values, but there is a risk of a major misunderstanding underlying them, since it is clear that the anthropology on which these values depend is now profoundly different from the anthropology that originally generated them and that is steeped in Christianity. European values thus end up being a shell inside which fluid realities are dynamically evolving and upon which it is difficult to build societies that are multifaceted and multi-ethnic like our own. From this perspective, the importance of the Pope's repeated call for a healthy secularity is evident. Healthy secularity means recognizing the public character of religious experience as positive and significant for the development of society, regardless of the beliefs of individuals. It is not by eliminating the symbols of faith that we facilitate social cohesion and integration. Only on the contrary, starting from the affirmation of differences and particularities, we can build bridges of dialogue that, while valuing differences, facilitate areas of convergence and thus become a cause for unity. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, with this brief speech, I want to use the title of this conference as a starting point for the discussion that will follow. These are essentially considerations that stem from the more attentive and in-depth reflection that the Holy Father has developed on Europe in recent years. I trust that the panels in the coming days will bring further important insights to help heal our Europe from the wounds that still burden it. I wish you every success and thank you for your kind attention.